Okay, so briefly we'll look at the objectives of a light rail transit system, characteristics of modern tramways, tram types, costs of tramways, and some examples. So firstly, the objectives of a light rail system. So first thing is, something that's already been sort of stressed, I think it's going to be one of the most important points at the moment, is to reduce the number of cars and the associated pollution, noise and congestion. To improve accessibility, so for social and economic reasons. Improve transport quality, reliability, speed and comfort. Something's gone wrong with the force, isn't it? It improves the image of a city, and it's can improve the sort of overall environment, the landscaping sort of quality. So looking at characteristics of modern tramways. So these are primary items that make something the tramways feasible. So we start off, they're environmentally friendly, so zero emissions in operation, although obviously there are emissions elsewhere, part of the electricity generation. Quiet running, so that's good for passengers and the local environment. They're comfortable, suspension's good these days, but large windows, good internal environment. integration with other transport modes, and that is key part that's already been stressed. So connectivity to the wider community. Tramway is a bit like a railway, it's a linear piece of infrastructure, but it needs to attract from a hinterland. Obviously, the further away you get from it, the less attractive it is, but if you've got a good bus service that connects and good interchanges, then that improves that overall. So integrated ticketing, again, something that Andrew and Lewis have touched on, very important, and something that's sort of being put into place on the Midlands Metro in the next 12 months. Again, why do you want to have multiple tickets or have the faff of buying those at each interchange or even based on season tickets, one to another mode? Park and ride is an important part of it, as well as bus connectivity. So give people the opportunity to get to a central location and catch it. It's already a big thing with buses, and York was used as an example earlier where public transport uptake hasn't been good, but they've got quite good bus infrastructure now, but it's still not attractive. Urban integration is very important, and it enhances the image of towns and cities as well, and that's already been sort of proven, certainly in France and in the UK, so Manchester being a good example, as well as Edinburgh. West Midlands Metro is improving that now. They've gone from the existing line, which is largely on the next rail corridor. There is now much more urban integration that we've completed and are sort of underway. Streets gate quality can improve significantly, and we're due to open the Edgbaston extension towards the end of this year. That goes along Broad Street, if anybody knows that in Birmingham, it's a sort of major sort of thoroughfare and sort of centre of nightlife. But the urban rail finishes have been sort of massively enhanced, and it looks really good now. As before, it was a bit grotty and run down. Unfortunately, we can't change the buildings. Well, there is a lot of urban renewal as well in some places. So trams are particularly accessible, pedestrian access, and particularly persons with restricted mobility. Big issue, and again, something that Andrew touched on earlier. We've got flush platforms, very small clearances between tram and platform edge. We've put in special measures now. We've come up with our own design that we're expecting to be sort of copied elsewhere on other networks for paving and signage platforms. Trams are high capacity. So there's a lot of standing room on the tram, but there are seats as well. But part of the standing room, if you like, is capacity for PRMs and wheelchairs and other mobility vehicles, people with pushchairs and trolleys. And the other thing with trams that make them attractive are short headways. So 5-6 minutes is quite common. You don't need a timetable, you know that a tram's going to come along shortly. And the other thing as well, you can change the length of a vehicle once it's in service if you want to increase capacity. And trams tend to be much longer than buses, even bendy buses, so you've got good capacity from that. The trams are generally fast and reliable, they've got dedicated right of way, and they get priority to intersections. It's integrated into the urban traffic control system, and sails through, especially in lights of drivers. Okay, so impact on local trade and property. So local trade, you do get better accessibility. Again, very often there's a resistance from local shopkeepers in particular. We don't want that. You know, it's going to take away ability people to get to us. Then often see an improvement. And that was a bit similar in the 1990s with pedestrianisation of town centres. Traders didn't want that. They thought that cars should have the right to park outside their stalls. And they realised then that they've got a lot more business. Things are changing now with online shopping. That's a different issue. So better accessibility to retail and nightlife and pubs, clubs and restaurants. So renewal of shops. Some shops see a massive increase in footfall that they didn't see before, just because they're on the route. So we get an improved image associated with that. And we've seen areas where it's been urban rail improvement, but people have invested in their shopfronts. Trams can be a boost for economic activity. From a property point of view, the area becomes attractive. So there are studies, certainly for West Midlands Metro, where it's shown that the proximity to the existing tram network and even planned networks at the moment is having a positive impact on local property prices. Urban renewal, again, enhanced streetscape is a big issue, and it's an opportunity, putting the tram infrastructure in, to give place a facelift that just gives that positive feeling, and that's gives an enhancement to the area, and again increases in land value. So economic efficiency. So you get a boost to local economic activity through better travel. It's easier for people to get to work and to shop and go out. And again, this sort of comes back to one of the slides I think Andrew showed, showed the return on investment for public transport infrastructure, increased land value, better revenues, patronage goes up on a tram compared with buses. You can sort of see 200% increases, and better cost recovery ratio as a result. Benefits as economic feasibility. You've got to keep the investment reasonable, it's got to be sensible and appropriate, and urban renewal is good, but it's got to be in context, it's got to be suitable, and it should show some return on investment. Well, some of that can be social as well as economic complexes, and operating costs have got to be looked at as well. So introducing a tramway can bring a new look to a city. So if we look at Nantes, so as Andrew mentioned earlier, so first tramway lines, but I can't cross the line slide there. So 85 construction projects currently underway in the Nantes area as a result, partly of the tramway, and it's going to feed those in the future. And 13 urban renewal projects as part of the scheme along the corridor as well. And in Grenoble, big renovation project for the historical downtown area off the back of the tramway. And the railway station district, which is also quite run down, is also being renewed off the back of the tram. So in terms of urban renewal, we've got regeneration of the central square area. So if you've got a town centre, you take the tram through it, it's a good opportunity to improve that. That's something that's actually happened in Birmingham with the recent extension that was opened in 2019. It goes straight past the town hall. There's an opportunity been taken there. We've got a section of catenary free running, and West Midlands Metro invested heavily on battery operation. Their trams has major upgrade on existing fleet, and all of the third generation trams that are being procured at the moment are going to be battery operated, and that's particularly significant through sort of town centre areas. But this sort of decision, I suppose, partly as a leading body on this, there's pros and cons of the OLE, And it's just thought that in some areas it's appropriate not to have early. But it does come at a cost. And again, looking at sort of examples in Europe, yeah, the Strasbourg example is a particular one. There's enhancement of the area, there's a vision, sort of visual statement, yeah, this is the tram, it's here. So if we look at the components of the tram, yeah, it's got three key components. We've got the infrastructure, which is the heavy civils work. It's got the systems, which is important to make the civils works function, along with the rolling stock. And we've all seen Crossrail as an example where the systems has been the difficult part. So it's important to consider that at the start, how that's going to work, not as an afterthought. So looking at the integration into the cityscape, again, looking at Strasbourg, we have high visibility, or Bordeaux, the ground power system, yeah, can be quite discreet, but again, that comes at a cost. And potential reliability issues, which is a new novel system. So, going on from that, from a feasibility point of view, there's often an objection as well, what about operation sort of through crowded areas? It's proven to work quite well. Trams operate on line of sight, there are signals, but those are for junctions typically, and stops and crossovers. Yeah, tram drivers are highly trained, and yeah, they operate at lower speeds, where you've got pedestrians in England. So there are, as with any transport mode, the occasional issue, but generally it's safe, very safe even. So if you look at rolling stock evolution, sort of slides there from Leeds in the 1930s, traditional tram style that we see on heritage lines in the UK. So obviously moved on a long way from that, moving on to Saint-Étienne in 1950. More closed vehicle, Grenoble in 1980, Lyon in 2000, those trams are still in operation. Now, still very good, Reims 2010 and Nice in 2020. So, rolling stock characteristics, very important. Modular composition, so they can be expanded if necessary. They're articulated vehicles that fit the curves. So you find on tramways in city centre, but you do have small radii curves. City centres are much more challenging than heavy rail corridors for obvious reasons, a lot of restrictions with surrounding buildings. We've got low floors for improved accessibility, and they're tailored to needs of a tramway and to taste. So there's a lot of variations on rolling stock. So looking at modularity, so we go from sort of 20 metres, which I think we've got in Besançon, 30 metres, we've got 35 metres on the middle of the metro at the moment, and capacity. So you can go from 140 to 300 by just adding extra modules. And you can do that as a part of a long-term upgrade to the fleet if the demand requires it. So looking at systems, very important, mentioned before, you've got to look at traffic priority, operation supervision, centralisation in one control centre. And again, it's buses have control centres, but because of the number of bus companies, it doesn't work very well. If there's an issue on a tramway, it's one control centre, so it determines the whole fleet. So if necessary, you can stop everything if there's an issue. So from a security point of view, you've got a number of systems. You've got fire detection, you've got CCTV, passenger assistance units, sort of things on tram stops. And PA, which you don't tend to get with buses, to give passenger updates. And then for passengers, you've got passenger information displays, which is you get on mainline rail, although you do get that with buses these days as well. You've got access control as well. So from an environmental point of view, as I said before, we've got zero emissions at point of use, limited noise and vibration impacts. One part of designing tramway is to look at the existing noise and vibration levels and make sure what we do is no worse. And often this is much better than heavy traffic and buses. And typically trams are visually unobtrusive, even with OLE. And particularly in city centres, if you're not going for a continuity free option, then you can look at the building mounting option, which is used widely. Ground powered systems or onboard energy storage, like battery. There are proposals for hydrogen and as Andrew knows, sort of methane. So tram types, so sort of broken this down into four key areas. So conventional trams, if you like, which I guess we've got on the Midland Metro at the moment, high quality materials, facade to facade development, as I mentioned, we've done on Broad Street in Birmingham. And sort of got reasonable quality architectural stations, depots and buildings. So it's, again, enhanced urban environment typically. Interstation distance of 400 to 600 metres, and that's the same for all forms of city centre tram, if you like. Vehicle capacity, 200 to 300, and headway of 3 to 5 minutes at peak hours. And then cost per kilometre, 20 to 25 million. Now that does vary quite a lot, as we'll see later on. Short trams, such as we designed them, we've involved with procurement off of the Besançon system in France. Again, using high quality materials. We've got higher quality stops, but the depot buildings and sort of OCC and those sorts of things are more functional, but they're not highly visible. Capacity 130 to 160, but again, it's modular, it can be expanded, and they are, some of those trams are looking at being extended at the moment, as the network has become very popular. And again, same sort of service pattern, slightly lower development cost. Sort of put an economical sort of tram option in there, saying less expensive materials, and it's only sort of highway curb to curb development, so there's no other urban realm enhancements, and sort of very basic tram stops and depot buildings. And it tends to be a lower headway as well. And then we've got the express option, such as we have Aegis designed in Lyon, and that takes you sort of from Lyon Airport into the city centre, and those sort of interstop distances are sort of 2 to 5 kilometres. So it's a much more sort of rapid system. And the headway is sort of 15 to 20 minutes rather than sort of 5 minutes. But the cost is much lower, sort of 5 to 12 billion, I think. So obviously, as you get into the urban area, that increases. So looking at the cost of tramways, got a table here. There's a lot of facts and figures. Unfortunately, it's not all displayed. That's close. Standing where he is. So, Manchester Metro Phase 1 in 1992, it's got a very low cost per kilometre in £7 million, which is inflated significantly. So they had the benefit there, they were doing a lot of that work in old rail corridors. If you move on to sort of more recent projects, so the Nottingham Express Transit in 2015, so the cost of £34 million per kilometre. Midland Metro, Birmingham City Centre extension opened in 2015, before we were involved, and that's £50 million. And then looking at sort of UK costs, this is more relevant to Kennex, and the Midland Metro costs at the moment. We've got quite a range of costs per kilometre. So city centre costs are very high. But Wolverhampton City Centre extension, £48 million per kilometre equivalent. Metro West Side extension, which runs from Birmingham New Street Station out to Edgbaston on Hadley Road, if any of you know that. And that is running at £67 million per kilometre, which again seems very high. And the real opener is the Metro East Side extension, which runs from City Centre, the existing line, out to Digbeth and underneath the new HS2 Curzon Street Station, which looks eye-watering, £134 million a kilometre. There's a reason for that, and there are some very significant property purchase costs in there, as well as demolition costs and purchase of some of the 3G trams are factored into that project as well. And then the largest extension that we're working on at the moment is the Wensbury to Briony Hill extension, 11 kilometres long, and that's got a cost of £41 million. Again, that's got some hidden costs, if you like, and I think there's something like £50 or £60 million of tram costs in that as well. So, not quite as one of the difficulties we have in the UK, if you look at the French figures below, is the cost of utility diversions, which there's less of an issue in France, but with the powers they've got, I think it's a case of two utility companies moving the utilities. And there's a number of utilities that are owned and operated by the local authorities in France as well. In the UK, sadly, the local authorities don't have the influence over the utility companies, and those costs are significantly higher as a result. It's something that doesn't need to be factored in, but again, it's part of the strategy for developing a new network to get that right from the start. So very quickly, in extra time, got a breakdown of where the costs go. We've got rolling stock in there, it's 25%. The next largest cost is utilities, as I just mentioned. And you've got civil infrastructure. And then on top of that, you've got rail infrastructure, track bed and track work, roadways, highways, and so on. So some examples, I'm afraid these are all from France, but good examples of what can be done. So looking at population and equivalents. So Brest population 214,000, 28 stops, 14 kilometres, headway 6 minutes, 35,000 passengers a day, £24 million per kilometre. So Dijon population again 250,000, 5 minute headway, 200 passenger capacity tram, 84,000 passengers a day, £20 million per kilometre. Rouen, again, 500,000, half a million population, which if you look at the sort of combined area around here, it's probably sort of approaching that level. 31 tram stops, 7 minute headway, 80,000 passengers a day. That's a lot of road vehicles taken off the road, and particularly with the sort of current reliance on the Thames crossing. M25, that can make a big impact. An investment of £26 million per kilometre. Le Mans, 190,000 population, 5 minute headway, 50,000 passengers a day. That's a good take. Rennes, population 214,000. So again, scalable. The local area, headway 5 minutes, 45,000 passengers a day. It's a lot of cars, it's a lot of pollution removed from the local environment. Besançon, it's one of our sort of, if you like, pet projects. We don't know, we thought it was sort of viable. This is a small tram. They've got some very narrow streets, sort of historical area. So the population is 180,000. So we've got 31 stops, headway of 5 minutes. It takes 35,000 passengers a day. Made a big improvement on the local area in terms of traffic, and they are looking to expand both the network and the size of the existing vehicles by adding more modules. So that's proved highly successful. Lyon, again, this is an example of an economic tram, it's got a very distinctive shape. Sort of reflect the local silk industry. It's supposed to reflect the sort of shape of the silkworm. Population 1.3 million. So that's it. Number of state stops 10. So it's a lot more than that now. It's probably more like 100. 8 minute headway. I think those numbers are around as well. 31,500 passengers a day. I think that must be the line one. And the Rhone Express, that's the high-speed link to Lyon Airport. Again, very effective, sort of reduced headway, but it doesn't need to be 5 minute headway. say 2,500 passengers a day. But it's not a huge tram fleet, but it works very well. It's much quicker than driving, I can attest to that. And the cost per kilometre is much lower. One of the other advantages they have in France is there's a lot more land than in the UK. That's another factor in the UK.